Hello everyone, and welcome back to Math 131a, Week 5, Lecture 1. Let's begin by recalling the material covered in the previous lecture. We have proved the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem. A very important result with many applications. So let's recall that it says that every bounded sequence of real numbers has a convergent subsequence. The result of this theorem allows for us to conclude in certain specific situations that a particular sequence is convergent without actually having to calculate its limit. Sometimes, either given a theoretical problem or some particular sequence, it might be quite difficult to calculate its limit. So the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem provides us a general method, a sufficient condition to conclude that at least we can find the convergent subsequence of such a sequence. And let's briefly recall two important ingredients on which the proof of the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem relies. So the first ingredient was the lemma, which allowed us to extract the convergent subsequence under certain specific conditions. And in fact, more precisely, it provides a characterization, so an if and only if statement, for existence of a convergent subsequence. So we refer to this as the extracting a convergent subsequence lemma. And I refer for the details to the previous video. And the second ingredient is the very important principle about the real numbers, the so-called nested intervals principle, or as we called it, the nested intervals lemma. So this is a result which tells us that if we are given a sequence of closed nested intervals, so let's recall, we think about them as given a sequence of intervals in, where the interval in is a closed interval with the endpoints an and bn, such that in is less than bn, both are real numbers. So an, bn, inr. And the nested requirement corresponds to saying that the interval in contains the interval in plus 1 for all n. So as n increases, the intervals decrease, so they all refine each other as n grows. And then, given such a sequence, a nested sequence of closed intervals of real numbers, then there exists some real number s, which belongs to the intersection of all of these intervals. So such that S belongs to IN for all N natural numbers, which equivalently can be written as saying that S belongs to the intersection of the sets IN, where N varies over all natural numbers. So this is just a different notation to represent the same intersection. So this is part one, that any nested sequence of intervals has a non-empty intersection. And the second point is that if the length of these intervals go to zero, so if we have that the sequence bn minus an converges to zero, then such an S is unique. So this is the first result. Let's remark also that this principle is in fact equivalent to the completeness axiom of the real numbers. So we don't go into the details on that. What we did is establish the nested intervals lemma using the completeness axiom, but it's also possible to do things in reverse and to use the nested intervals lemma, assume it as an axiom, and in turn deduce the completeness axiom from this, which in that case would be the completeness lemma. So these two properties of the real numbers are in fact equivalent to each other. So each one can be deduced from the other one. Okay, So this was the second crucial ingredient in the proof of the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem. And the second topic, which was an application of Bolzano-Weierstrass, is the proof that for sequences of real numbers, we have that Sn is a convergent sequence of real numbers if and only if Sn is Cauchy. So we refer to this result as the Cauchy completeness theorem. And it's a very important result. Once again, so note that the definition on the left requires specifying some limit. So it requires saying in advance that there is some real number S, such that all the elements of the sequence eventually get closer and closer to S. The Cauchy condition, on the other hand, doesn't specify any limit in advance, but just says that the elements of the sequence get closer and closer to each other as we look further and further into the sequence. So, and even though these two conditions on the face of it are not necessarily obviously equivalent, we were able to use Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem to prove that for sequences of real numbers, they're the same. So in fact, Bolzano-Weierstrass was needed to prove the implication from right to left, right? So the implication left to right is an easy one. Okay, so this was the material from the previous lecture where we stopped. So now let's talk about the material for today's lecture. Today, we are going to discuss infinite series or sometimes just series when we don't mention the word infinite explicitly. This is also often referred to as the infinite sums, which we put in the quotation marks. The reason being that the notion of an infinite sum is not self-evident. In fact, it's non-trivial to actually make sense of what it means for us to consider the sum of, let's say, real numbers am for m varying from 1 to infinity. So, of course, we know the familiar operation of addition on the real numbers, which allows us to add up one real number to another one, and iterating this operation, we can add up any finite number of real numbers to each other. However, to make sense of an infinite sum, it seems that we would like to introduce some limiting procedure, which basically should tell us that when we look at partial sums, when we only sum the elements of this sequence am up to some finite number n, this gives us partial sums for the sequence, and then we would like to say that these partial sums actually converge to some limit, which then it would be natural to refer to as the actual sum for the sequence. So this is just to stress that the meaning of an infinite sum is non-trivial, and in fact it has to be introduced rigorously, which we are able to do using limits of sequences. So in fact, as we will see in a minute, infinite series are just a special kind of sequences, nothing else. So these are just sequences of special form where the elements of the sequences are given by certain finite sums of real numbers. Then we will consider some particular examples. Is particular very important geometric series where the elements are given by expressions of the form, let's say 1 over 2n, for n varying from 1 to infinity. And another crucial example is the so-called harmonic series, where this is just the sum of 1 over n. So these two are the first examples one can probably think about when one starts investigating the nature of such infinite sums. Once we discuss some examples, the last topic we will start discussing, which will take us probably more than one lecture to consider, is the various will consist of various convergence tests. So convergence tests. So this is a number of results which allow us a simpler method, a simpler sufficient condition to evaluate whether a given series converges or not, where we say that a series converges if the sequence of its partial sums converges. So often in practice it's quite hard to actually calculate the sum of such a series, but at least determining whether it goes to infinity or it converges to some real number. Often there are simpler sufficient conditions which are easier to verify for particular examples. So we'll see several of these tests which were applicable in different situations. So let's begin with the discussion of series. And as I already remarked, series are just a special case of sequences. So all the results that we have established for sequences concerning their convergence, etc., they all can be applied to series, but of course one has to be careful to make sure that we apply them correctly. So our goal is going to be to assign, and crucially, we should add a conditional if possible, some mathematical meaning to the infinite sum, which we can write as am plus am plus 1 plus am plus 2, etc., where an with n greater or equal than m is a sequence of real numbers. Okay. Yeah, so we are given a sequence of real numbers. We would like to evaluate the sum of all elements of the sequence, or sometimes it, maybe we want to refer to the sum as infinity, depending on the situation. Okay, so to make rigorous the notion of a sum for such a sequence, we are going to define partial sums. So definition for each capital N greater or equal than M, we define the real number S capital N to be the sum of all the elements of the sequence, so the elements AN for N varying from M, the initial element of the sequence, so the sequence starts with AM, all the way up to the index capital N. Yeah? So this is just the sum AM plus AM plus 1 plus AM plus 2, etc. And the last summand is A capital N. So note that this is a real number simply because we are taking a finite sum of finitely many real numbers. So it's a familiar operation, yeah? We know that adding a bunch of real numbers gives us a real number. Okay, now we are going to call the corresponding sequence. So we call the sequence which is formed by these partial sums. So this is the sequence S capital N, with capital N greater or equal than M. So we refer to the sequence as the sequence of partial sums associated to the original sequence AN. Okay, so as you see, we start with some sequence AN. And then, using it, we build another sequence, the sequence of partial sums with respect to the sequence AN, which we'll typically denote as SN. But of course, there's nothing special, but we'll try to stick to this notation. So the sequence of partial sums, SN. All right, so this is part one of the definition. The second part, now, to make sense of when such a series converges, we are going to define it in terms of the convergence of this associated sequence of partial sums. So we're going to say that the infinite series given by the summation over all an, and this time we sum over all elements of the sequence, so n varies from m to infinity, we say that such an infinite series converges if the sequence of partial sums converges. So SN converges. And note that here convergence for the sequence SN is just in the usual sense of convergence. Nothing new, yeah? So just convergence of a sequence of real numbers. Now, why this intuitively the meaning for convergence for an infinite sum? Well, simply because we think about partial sums as approximating the result of summing the whole sequence closer and closer, and then we to make sense of a sum for an infinite sequence, we just pass to a limit. So we're thinking that the partial sums approximate some real number, or maybe infinity, and then we want to define convergence of this infinite series in terms of the convergence of such partial sums. Okay, and let's be completely clear in this definition. So when we say the sequence of partial sum convergence, we think again in terms of the convergence of the usual sequence of real numbers. So converges means that it converges to some real number S, let's say, yeah. So we're not talking about convergence to plus infinity or minus infinity in this case, but actually convergence to some real number. Okay. So in other words, if just writing it symbolically, if S is equal to the limit of the sequence of partial sums, so the sums from M to capital N, AN, as capital N goes to infinity, which is the same thing as the limit of the sequence as N, capital N again, excuse me, as capital N goes to infinity. Now, in this case, when S is the limit of the sequence as capital N, as N capital N goes to infinity, we will write that the sum, the infinite sum of AN for N varying from infinity to, for N varying from M to infinity, excuse me, is equal to S. Yeah? So this is just notation. By itself, this expression is meaningless. However, we define it to be a real number in terms of some particular real number obtained as the limit of partial sums. Yeah? So this is notation. This is not some intrinsic meaning. This is, we're introducing what we mean by a sum of an infinite sequence. It's okay. Now, given this definition, we will also say that an infinite sum, which does not converge, is said to diverge. Okay, so it's a simple definition by negation. So if the sequence of partial sums, or thinking about it as an infinite sum, so if an infinite sum does not converge in the sense we just defined, then we say that it diverges. As with sequences, it's possible to diverge in many different ways, with some of these ways more regular than some others. So specifically, if the sequence of partial sums, S capital N, diverges to plus infinity, respectively to minus infinity, then we will similarly say that the infinite series, or the infinite sum, of AN with N varying from M to infinity diverges to plus infinity, respectively, to minus infinity. So, as before, we simply extend the corresponding notion from sequences to infinite sums via the partial sums. So, via the sequence of partial sums associated to the infinite sum or to the infinite series. Okay. And notationally, in case when this condition happens, so we will write that the sum over all AN with N varying from M to infinity is equal to plus infinity in the first case, and respectively we can write that it's equal to minus infinity in the second case. Now, just a comment about notation. Sometimes when the range of the index of a sequence is clear, so in this case we are considering sequence AN with N varying from M to infinity. Sometimes when the range of the sequence is clear, so the set over which the indices vary, we might write simply the sum of an without explicitly specifying the limits of the sum when they're clear from the context. Yeah, so it's a slight abuse of notation, but sometimes we might omit it when it's clear from the context and there can be no confusion arising. Let's begin our discussion of series with a couple of remarks. So assume that we're given a sequence AN such that all elements of the sequence are non-negative. So we have that AN is greater or equal than 0 for all n greater or equal than m. Yeah, so the sequence that we're given is like this. Now, if you want to consider the associated sequence of partial sums, then we're going to have that the sequence S capital N with capital N greater or equal than m of partial sums associated to the sequence AN is increasing. So why is this true? Well, simply because remember how these partial sums are defined. So Sn is just the sum of all the elements An with index n varying from m up to capital N. So this is the definition of partial sums. And hence, if we have to compare two elements of the partial sum, so if we want to look at S capital N plus 1, this is simply going to be S capital N plus A capital N plus 1. And by assumption, A capital N plus 1 is non-negative, greater or equal than 0. Hence, we see that Sn plus 1 is greater or equal than Sn. And this is precisely what it means for the sequence of partial sums to be increasing. But now, in this case, it follows that the sum over all n from m to infinity of the elements of the sequence an either converges to a real number or diverges to plus infinity. Yeah? So simply because we have the sequence of partial sums is increasing, then there are only two possibilities. Either it converges when it's bounded or it diverges to plus infinity, as long as the elements of the sequence an are non-negative. In particular, we see that if we look at the infinite series, so the sum over all n from m to infinity, of the absolute values of an, then this series either converges or diverges to plus infinity for any sequence of real numbers an with n greater or equal than m. So no matter what sequence of real numbers we start with, the series formed by the absolute values of the elements of this sequence either converges or diverges to plus infinity. And now this remark motivates us to make the following definition. So we say that an infinite series given by the sum an with n varying from m to infinity is said to be absolutely convergent if the series given by the absolute values of the elements of this sequence converges. So to reiterate it once again, a series is absolutely convergent if the series formed by the absolute values of the elements of this sequence converges. Now it's time to consider some examples of these newly introduced notions. also example one. And it's a very important series that often arises in various areas of mathematics. So the so-called geometric series. We suppose that m is equal to 0, an is equal to r to the power n, where r is a real number which is not equal to 1. Then, for any capital N greater or equal than 0, we can look at the sum given by the sum over all r to the power n, where n varies from 0 to capital N. And we claim that the sum, so this is a finite sum, the sum is equal to 1 minus r to the power capital N plus 1 divided by 1 minus r. This sum is a very important fact. This is the so-called geometric progression formula. So this is a result about finite geometric progressions. Let's quickly derive this formula. So we want to show that this equality is indeed valid. So it gives us a closed form expression on the right hand side, which allows us to lay this potentially very large sum on the left. Okay, so how do we prove this? We consider the sum on the left hand side and multiply it by 1 minus r. So we look at the expression 1 minus r times the sum over all n from 0 to n r to the power n. Now using distributivity, this is equal to 1 times the sum, which is just the sum itself, minus r times the sum now the first sum stays unchanged for a minute, and in the second sum we just multiply each summand by r, so we have the minus the sum over all n from 0 to capital N r to the power n plus 1. So if we write the sums out, we get 1, so this is r to the power 0 plus r square, etc., all the way up to r to the power capital N minus, and now we have the second sum, but here it starts with r as opposed to 1, because when n is equal to 0, we get r to the power 1, which is just r. Then we have plus r square, plus etc., plus r to the power capital N, plus r to the power capital N plus 1. And now you see that most of things in the sums cancel out. So we have plus r minus r, plus r square minus r square, etc. We have plus rn minus r to the power n, and what we are left with is 1 minus r to the power n plus 1. But now, given this equality, and note that this derivation that we wrote is not entirely rigorous, it explains what's going on, but to make it rigorous, you actually should form it as an argument by mathematical induction, where you induct on capital N. But I believe that by now you are able to easily transform this into a formal proof. But now, given this equality, so we have that the sum on the left is equal to this expression. And so multiplying both sides, or rather dividing by 1 minus r, we get that the sum on the left, so we divide it by 1 minus r, so it cancels out, is equal to 1 minus r to the power n plus 1 divided by 1 minus r. And so this is the desired expression for the partial sum. Our next task is to estimate the limit of partial sums. first of all note that for r with absolute value smaller than 1, we have that the limit of r to the power n plus 1 with capital N going to infinity is equal to 0. How do we know this? Well, this is an example we have considered earlier, especially when we discussed the squeeze lemma for sequences and various other examples of basic limits for common sequences. So, because we know by that discussion that you can find in the earlier videos or lecture notes, that the limit of a to the power n is equal to 0 for any real number a with the absolute value smaller than 1, of course, as n goes to infinity. Okay? And so in this case, what we have is a sequence accelerated by 1. So we know the limit for that sequence. But now note that the power is in fact n plus 1 as opposed to n. And we know that accelerating a sequence by any finite shift of its indices doesn't change the limit. Okay, so this is a separate observation. We also know that for any sequence of real numbers Sn, which we assume converges to S, we can consider the sequence S prime n, where we have that S prime n is given by S n plus 1, so it's the limit of the original sequence, but with index increased by 1. So we accelerate the sequence by 1, but it doesn't affect the limit. So the limit of this new sequence, S prime n, is still the same. So it also converges to S. So it's a general fact. We either discussed it earlier, or I recommend you think about it for a minute. It's easy to check from the definition of limits. Okay. So now given these two facts, it's easy to see that indeed the limit of r to the power n plus 1 is 0 as n goes to infinity. Given this, we can finally evaluate the sum of the series, for which we have that the sum of r to the power n for n varying from 0 to infinity, by definition, is taken to be the limit of the partial sums. So we take the limit of the sum from n goes equal to 0 up to capital N, r to the power n, so this is a real number, and we take the limit of this sequence of real numbers when n goes to infinity. Now, using our previous calculation, we can replace this expression. So this is the same as the limit as n goes to infinity of 1 minus r to the power n plus 1 divided by 1 minus r. Now, in order to calculate this limit, we can use the limit laws. The only non-trivial point is that we just made that the limit of r to the power n plus 1 is 0 as long as the absolute value of r is smaller than 1. Hence, this is equal to 1 minus 0, which we don't write, divided by 1 minus r. So this is just an application of the convergence laws, where the sequences 1, 1, and the sequence r are three constant sequences, and the non-constant sequence r to the power n plus 1 converges to 0. Okay, so we see that this is a real number. Hence, the sum converges, or the series converges, under the assumption that the absolute value is smaller than 1. So this converges when the absolute value of r is smaller than 1. And in fact, this argument shows that the series converges absolutely. Now, a separate question is what happens when the absolute value of r is greater than 1, when, in this case, we will see later that the series diverges. However, we will need some criterion to be able to establish it that we will introduce later in this lecture. We move on to the next topic, convergence criteria. As we have mentioned earlier, it is often rather difficult to determine whether a particular sum converges or not. Towards this purpose, there are several criteria which are easier to check, which allow us to answer this question. Sometimes these criteria are actually equivalent to the series being convergent or not. In some other situations, these are just sufficient criteria, so they only ensure that once a particular criterion that we will discuss holds, then the series converges, but not necessarily vice versa. We begin with a particularly important criterion, the so-called Cauchy criterion. So this is definition. We say that an infinite series, An, with the sum from m to infinity satisfies the Cauchy criterion. So it's the same mathematician after whom the property of a sequence being Cauchy is named, and you will see the relation between these two notions in a minute. So we say that such an infinite series satisfies the Cauchy criterion if the sequence Sn with capital N greater or equal than M of its partial sums is a Cauchy sequence. Okay. So let's unwind this definition to have it all in front of our eyes. So this is equivalent to saying, remembering the definition of a Cauchy sequence and the definition of the sequence of partial sums and combining the two, we see that this is equivalent to saying that for every real epsilon greater than zero, there exists some integer n0 greater or equal than m, so it's some position in the sequence, such that if we look at the difference of the partial sums, so we look at the partial sum corresponding to capital N, and we look at the partial sum corresponding to capital N prime, and we look at the difference between these two, the absolute value of the difference, we require that this is smaller than epsilon for all n and prime greater or equal than n0. So this is just a rephrasement, remembering the definition of what it means for the sequence of partial sums to be a Cauchy sequence. Note that in this definition, we may also assume that n is greater than n prime. So the point here is that the absolute value of the difference of the two partial sums, Sn and Sn prime, it doesn't depend on the order of n and n prime. So if we exchange the roles of n and n prime, so if we look at the absolute value of the difference between Sn prime and Sn, it's equal to the absolute to the initial absolute value. And so it's enough to require that this holds when capital N is greater than N capital prime, because if it holds for all such, then it also holds for all N different from N prime, because the order doesn't matter for the, from the point of view of the absolute value. Okay, now with this in mind, we can look at the meaning of this difference of partial sums. So we have Sn minus Sn prime, and then this is equal to a n prime plus 1 plus a n prime plus 2 plus etc. plus A capital N. So we see that the elements of the partial sum as capital N, so since N is greater than N prime, it contains the sum, contains all the elements, all the summons appearing in the sum as N prime, plus the additional ones with indices between N prime and capital N. And so we can write out these elements like this. And so the definition of bin cache for a sequence is equivalent to the following. So if we denote this condition by star, so we have that star is equivalent to the following. So for each epsilon greater than zero real number, there exists n0 greater or equal than m such that the absolute value of the difference of partial sums, which we just expressed as a n prime plus 1 plus a n prime plus 2 plus etc. plus a n, is smaller than epsilon for all n greater than n prime greater or equal than n0. So this is an equivalent way to phrase the criterion star. But now, if we take n prime plus 1 instead of n prime, we get that the second expression is equivalent to the criterion that we denote as the asterisk, which says that for each epsilon greater than 0, there exists n0 greater or equal than m, such that the sum given by the, so the absolute value of the sum, a n prime plus a n prime plus 1 plus etc. plus a n is smaller than epsilon for all n greater or equal than n prime greater than n0. This is immediate from the previous condition by reindexing. So we replace n prime by n prime plus 1 and apply the previous criterion with respect to it. Now this criterion asterisk, following the sequence of equivalences, is just another way to formulate the Cauchy criterion. So this is the Cauchy criterion that is will often be used. Having formulated the meaning of a series satisfying the Cauchy criterion, we quickly get the following corollary. The series AN with n varying from m to infinity converges if and only if it satisfies the Cauchy criterion. And the proof of this corollary is straightforward once we employ the fact that we have proved earlier, namely that for a sequence of real numbers, convergence is equivalent to being Cauchy. So proof, by definition, the series AN converges if and only if the sequence of partial sums converges, which is equivalent by the Cauchy completeness theorem to the fact that the sequence of partial sums is a Cauchy sequence and by the definition we just made, this is the same as saying that the series AN satisfies the Cauchy criterion. So this result, this corollary is just a rephrasement of the result that we have proved earlier, that for sequences of real numbers, being Cauchy is equivalent to being convergent. So note that the Cauchy criterion is both a necessary and sufficient criterion for convergence of a given series, because we have if and only if here. In practice, when dealing with infinite series, the first question you want to ask is whether the series converges or diverges. And sometimes it's difficult to apply the Cauchy criterion directly, being an if and only if criterion. For this purpose, there are several results which are known as convergence tests, which provide sufficient criteria for convergence which are easier to check. So we are not guaranteed that some of these tests that we will introduce, they don't always apply, because they are not if and only if, they only provide sufficient criteria, but they have the advantage of being easier to check for a particular sequence, whether they are satisfied or not. So the first test we consider is the so-called divergence test. This is probably the easiest one, which already is useful in many situations. So we have that if the series AN converges, then the sequence AN must converge to zero. So first, let's think about it for a second. Why is it true intuitively? So the sum is formed by adding the elements from the given sequence AN to each other. And so if the series converges, it means that the sequence of partial sums converges to some number. But then for this, in particular, it is bounded. But for it to be bounded, intuitively, it seems that then the elements AN appearing in the sum have to get smaller and smaller, because if they never did, they never approach zero, so they get smaller and smaller in absolute value. If they never approach zero, then keeping adding them to the sum, potentially the sum might keep growing forever. And so we see that there is this implication. Now the proof of this is very quick. Assume we are given some positive real number epsilon, and we want to show that there exists some index n such that all elements of the sequence an are within epsilon from zero. Okay, but then we simply take n to be n prime in the condition asterisk. If you remember the condition asterisk, what it says is precisely that the absolute value of the sum with the indices of the summons varying from n prime to n, which in this case just n prime itself, or n itself, so we get that the absolute value of an is smaller than epsilon for all capital N greater or equal than n prime greater than n0, where n0 some integer depending on epsilon, which is guaranteed to exist by the condition asterisk. And so the conclusion is that we see that the absolute value of an is smaller than epsilon for all n greater than n0. So note that the roles of the parameters notationally are slightly different from the usual notation we use in limits. So here the index of the elements of the sequence is given by capital N, while the integer such that all elements after it have absolute value smaller than epsilon is given by N0. So, of course, this is not important. We can use arbitrary letters to denote the meaning of the corresponding parameters. Okay, so for today we'll stop with this divergence test. And we will see many more tests in the next lecture. which all are useful and can be applied in different situations. So in some situations, some tests are better. In some other situations, different tests might be better. But the simplest one is this divergence test. So if we are given a sequence IN which does not converge to zero, then we are guaranteed that the series corresponding to the sequence, so the sum over IN, does not converge, taking the contrapositive of this implication. Okay, let's stop here for today, and thank you for your attention.